This is the In Context podcast with your host, Karin von Hippel.
Welcome to In Context, Russi's podcast with interesting, important people. We have a new schedule, so we will be doing these podcasts once a month. We would appreciate your feedback on this podcast, positive or negative, so please do leave a review for us wherever you get your podcasts. This week, we welcome Lord Robertson, the former Secretary General of NATO and the former Defense Minister in the United Kingdom. Welcome, Lord Robertson, to this episode of In Context, Russi's regular podcast with influential, interesting people. And we learn a bit about what motivates you and a bit about your career. So welcome.
Thank you. Lovely to be here.
So it's the Right Honorable the Lord Robertson of Port Ellen, who served as the 10th Secretary General of NATO and Chairman of the North Atlantic Council from October 1999 to January 2004. He was also the British Defense Secretary from 1997 to 99 and Labour Member of Parliament for Hamilton and Hamilton South. For how many years? 20, 30 years?
21 years.
You were appointed to the House of Lords in August 1999, and you sit as a Labour peer today.
That's right.
It's a lot already. It's a lot. There'll be a lot to talk about. So I understand you were born in a village police station. This is where it all started, in the village police station, because your father was the constable, the local village police chief.
He was the local policeman. Port Ellen is a village of 300 people, so it is one police station, quite a big police station, and in fact, an interesting police station because this is now the 75th anniversary of the publication of 1984, George Orwell's famous book, which he was writing at that time in Jura, the next door island to the island of Isla. And one night he failed to make the ferry to the mainland and, finding no other accommodation, asked my father if he could sleep in one of the cells. And he slept in one of the cells and his biographers say that that's probably the only experience he had of prison. So maybe Room 101 was based on Port Ellen Police Station, which is now renamed Robertson House, by the way.
Oh, that's wonderful. Yes, you're born on an island, right? Isla.
The island of Isla,
Isla in Scotland, where they make amazing whiskey. And you do come from a family of policemen. So your father and grandfather, your brother, your son, your nephew are all sorts of police officers, right? Are they not all village police officers?
Well, they were. My son and my nephew are both serving police officers, and my son was married to a police officer who's now retrained as a teacher. So, yeah, I was the aberration in the family. And I once said that to President Putin, and he said, no. He said, you are not an aberration, Mr. Secretary General. You are now the super policeman.
That's a very good point.
I don't think he's saying that now.
Yeah, probably not. And your mother was a French and German teacher on the island?
Latterly she was. And when we moved to a town called Dunoon, which is where I started to get involved in politics, so she was a teacher of modern languages there. And neither of her sons were terribly good at the subject she taught.
And this is obviously when you moved to Dunoon, there were more than 300 people there. Yeah. So there was actually enough kids to teach in the classroom.
Oh, yeah. It had a very good, famous secondary school called Dunoon Grammar School, which wasn't an English-type grammar school, but it was a territorial comprehensive. Everybody went there. And, John Smith, who was leader of the Labour Party, went there.
Right.
And other luminaries as well were educated in the same. But the town was only 9,500 people. So it was hardly a metropolis, but it was bigger than Port Ellen.
Right. Well, that's impressive. And I understand that come next year, you and your wife will be celebrating a momentous wedding anniversary.
We've survived together 50 years.
Congratulations.
At that point, if we get to the 1st of June next year, then that's the occasion.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And you have two sons and a daughter. So you mentioned, one of them is a police officer, but the other one?
The other son runs a large public affairs company in Edinburgh, and my daughter works for a whiskey company.
Okay, wonderful.
And yeah, she's a senior executive with that. Yeah, uh-huh. So another connection to my past.
Yes, very interesting. And then you went to the University of Dundee, and I guess at that time it was splitting from St. Andrews, and you could decide which degree you wanted to get. You stuck with Dundee, right? Is that correct?
I did, yeah.
And why did they split?
It was Queen's College Dundee as part of St. Andrews University. And that was the time in the 1960s when the Robbins Report was recommending the creation of new universities. So it made sense for Dundee, which was geographically different to St. Andrews. I had 3 years as part of St. Andrews University and 1 year as part of Dundee. So I'm involved with both. I chose to have my first degree from Dundee, but later on I got an honorary doctorate from St. Andrews, which made up for the fact that I'd had to make a choice away back in time.
Right, right. Well, good. Well, so you're a loyal alumni. And then you, just before you became an MP, you were a boilermaker.
No. I worked for the General Municipal and Boilermakers Union. So we were rather improbable boilermakers, it has to be said. But I was a full-time official of that union. But I looked after the Scotch whisky industry.
Right, an important industry. And any good stories about that period of time? Well, was whiskey that different back then, or was it always, the quality's always been exactly the same?
Well, the quality was there, and it was increasing in importance and in profitability. Mm-hmm. But it coincided with a period where I think the labour force felt that they'd been hard done by and had not shared in the prosperity of the industry. So there was a degree of militancy about, and here was I with my sort of university credentials and my sort of sentimentality burnished, and it was pretty soon knocked out of me, I have to say. If you have to argue with a group of striking workers at 8 o'clock in the morning and pouring rain at a factory gate, everything after that is really a piece of cake.
I found
that it was a grounding in experience and in life that was to help me through pretty well everything I did after that.
Bring on Milosevic. You can handle that. But do you consider yourself a whiskey connoisseur today?
I used to be. I visited most of the malt distilleries and the grain distilleries and sampled quite a few of them in time. However, I had a bad car crash later on, and after that got hepatitis, so I stopped drinking spirits of any kind. But, you know, like most politicians, even although I don't drink it, I can tell you what to drink.
Yes, well, my brother just returned from Scotland, and he had bought a teeny, teeny little bottle that was something like 70 pounds, just as a taster. And so I tried a wee bit, and I couldn't really tell. It was nice, but I couldn't probably tell the difference between that and something not as nice. So I'm sure your palate is much better than mine.
It probably is. And you can tell from the taste, whether it comes from Islay, where they're very heavily peated, or from Speyside, which is lighter and fragrant, or from the Orkney Isles. You know, there's a huge variety. And of course, it's an enormously important industry now. Right. You know, and the island of Islay, where I did the official opening of the 9th distillery. Mm-hmm. It's a population of only 3,000 in Islay.
Wow.
The 9th distillery, with two more actually in the planning process, you can see how valuable it is. Right. So when I was a kid, distilleries were just factories. They produced spirit, and they had notices saying keep out private property. Now they've got huge visitor centres, and they welcome hundreds of thousands of people to the island, attracted there because, you know, whiskey is so special.
It's the epicentre. But I know we're digressing a bit, but just one more question on whiskey, because aren't the big companies like Diageo hoovering up all the small distilleries, or are there still some independent ones left?
No, there's still independent ones left. But the other thing, even the big companies have got to keep the character of the individual distillery, you know, because that's where the premium and where the brand is important. So it's an essential industry in Scotland, But it's got to be, the quality has got to be protected. But it now attracts, you know, people from
all over the world.
All over the world. Yeah. You know, and, you know, even linking back to my future the career as it was, you know, I had to give gifts, as you you know, in the business we're in, this sort of exchange of gifts. And usually you gave sort of stainless steel trays with a NATO emblem in it, you know, and you knew they went straight into a cupboard.
Right.
You know? But I got Beaumont Distillery to produce a special bottle of 17-year-old Beaumont Islay Scotch whiskey, and I had my own label put on it. And it was a
trip. That always goes down well.
Absolutely went down. Wherever I went, you know, sort of, it was a great door opener.
Right. No, I can imagine that. I think we need to get some Roosie whiskey. So, and then you became a member of parliament in 1978 at the age of 32. A wee lad, right?
Were you? Well, everything's relative. There are now younger people coming in.
That's true. That's true. But, and basically you were an MP for the same place for a very long time, for 21 years, as we said. So that's quite impressive, actually. I mean, not many people do that anymore, do they?
Well,
they lose their seat at some point, right? There's some sort of disruption.
Well, yeah, they do. The average tenure is not huge and not long, but it was a very it was a secure seat, and I worked it very hard. It had been gone to the Nationalists in 1967, so you couldn't take anything for granted, and it went to the Nationalists after I left, as well. So you know, if you work hard and you do your job, then I was elected five times.
Mm-hmm.
It was a very famous by-election where I got elected in 1978. I was up against a lady called Margot MacDonald for the SNP. They expected to win the seat. It was you know, nationally covered because the issues were really big. Mm-hmm. If the Nationalists had made a breakthrough, then that would have perhaps created a role for them.
Mm-hmm.
But in fact, they didn't. Because she was, you know, sort of well-known anyway, I wasn't, but I was after that by winning the seat.
Yes, and that's where your football team is, right? That's why you support the...
Hamilton Academical.
Aggies, right? Yeah. Isn't that what they call them?
Yeah.
Right, because I hadn't heard of that team before, I have to confess.
Well, they're still in the Premier Division. They've survived again this year. So, you know, they're a small, you know, it's a small sort of struggling team in that, you know, sort of... the wild world of Scottish football,
right.
Almost as wild as the politics in Scotland. So, but Hamilton Aggies are still there.
And you're still an avid supporter.
Oh, yeah.
Well, then. And you got to be loyal to your team, I think. So then you went through a series of opposition positions, opposition spokesman on Scottish affairs, on defence, on foreign affairs, on Europe. And then you became Shadow Secretary of State for Scotland in 1993. Am I passing over any peak periods in those other positions in the earlier years?
You are, because these were real years of turmoil for the Labour Party in opposition. And I was one of the faction leaders.
The Thatcher years.
Yeah, but the Labour Party, of course, was going through a nervous breakdown at that time with a hard left and, trying to take control. So I was one of the leaders of the centre-right of the party, the pro-American, pro-European sort of element in there. I was secretary of a thing called the Manifesto Group. So we campaigned for one member, one vote. We campaigned against the militant tendency and for their expulsion. So, you know, in a way, I was running against the tide.
Yeah, right.
I stood for the shadow cabinet on a number of occasions and failed to get on. Mm. I was part of a defence team in the early 80s, and we were all sacked because we weren't unilaterals.
Mm-hmm.
And laterally, I worked with Dennis Healy, and I became the European spokesman, so that when the Maastricht Treaty negotiations came along, I led that. I was one of the few people
who knew anything about Europe, right?
Well, who was interested enough to know anything
Europe,
about
right.
Europe.
Right.
I led a team of people that led to the first defeat, major defeat, of the Conservative government in 14 years on the Maastricht Treaty. And I was named with Jeff Hoon as Joint Parliamentarians of the Year for what we did at that time. And I got elected to the Shadow Cabinet finally.
And would you say today some of those militant Labour tendencies are in, let's just say, you're coming back?
I fear that we're going back to some of these days. Mm-hmm. Some of the people that we threw out in these days because right. we thought they were dangerous are now coming back into the party. So another generation is going to have to pick up the cudgels and get the party right. back to being electable again.
Yeah, I guess it goes in swings and roundabouts, not just here, but in many countries, right? We're seeing that right now.
Well, we hope there's swings and roundabouts. Mm-hmm. You know, the worry might be it's all swings.
One direction,
and
right.
They're not going to come back.
Right, it's a bit concerning. Now, in this period, especially when you became Shadow Secretary of State, when you were in the opposition front benches, as I say, for Scotland, was that a period when Scottish independence was being pushed quite hard?
Well, the main opposition to us was the Nationalists, the SNP. You know, the Conservatives were in power, but they had a tiny support, declining support. So I had to put together the plan for the Scottish Parliament. We had to agree it in what was called the Scottish Constitutional Convention at the time. So that involved not just the Liberal Democrats and the Green Party, but also a huge range of Civic Scotland, you know, the churches, the unions, all sorts. And to get a consensus out of that was actually a good experience for later on in NATO. But then once we got that agreement, I had to get it through the National Party's mechanism intact. Mm-hmm. It had to be a plan that was worked on and agreed in Scotland. And that was the only element of the 1997 manifesto that had not gone through the sifting process at the UK level. So, you know, but that took a lot of time, a lot of trouble. And I think after that, everything else that I had to do was going to be easy by comparison. Mm. You know, being in Scottish politics is a ferocious experience then, and I think it still is now.
And how are you today? I mean, you're against Scottish independence, right?
Yeah.
My understanding. And are you still... Are you concerned that they might make another effort at another referendum, or?
Well, the SNP say they want another referendum, but the opinion hasn't really changed in Scotland at all.
You don't think they'd win?
No, they wouldn't. They certainly wouldn't win at the present moment. And although they've passed a resolution in the Scottish Parliament, you know, in their heart of hearts, until the opinion polls start to move, then. They're not going to be serious about a referendum. But people don't want another referendum. Right. They've had enough of referendums.
Right. Right.
And secondly, I think the idea of trying to split up the United Kingdom, given the experience of Brexit, is going to be very, very unattractive. You imagine the Scottish backstop, you know, imagine the currency issues, imagine the turmoil of trying to disentangle 300 years of union, never mind 40 years of union. So I remain implacably opposed to it, but I worry that English nationalism is on the rise.
Right.
And if Boris Johnson is, as is expected, the Prime Minister, I think, you know, a number of Scots might think, is my choice going to be between Jeremy Corbyn and Boris Johnson?
Right.
You know, their heads will say it doesn't make any sense. Their hearts, you know, might have some worries at this stage. But it would be disastrous for the country if we were to split up.
All right, Brexit could have some serious implications for Ireland, for Scotland. Very interesting.
Brexit is going to have huge repercussions in every element, you know. Yeah. And I think the union... You know, the union is in danger.
Right, the union
is being challenged. It's one of absolutely.
Okay, so then basically you then all of a sudden were in power, right? Tony Blair comes in and appoints you fairly quickly, right, as Defense Secretary.
Yeah, one day, the Friday morning, I'm Shadow Secretary of State for Scotland and I've got a staff of 3.5 people. And the next day at lunchtime, I'm... Britannic Majesty's Principal Secretary of State for Defence, and I've got 383,000 people working for me.
So, right. Yeah. So at least you were prepared, right? Mentally, because of all your experience up until then, but that's quite a transition. And then, of course, you really implemented a number of reforms. You were helping to modernize British Armed Forces. You did the first Strategic Defence Review, now known as the SDSR,
SDR.
SDR back then, but today the SDSR. And that was a very important change because I guess they hadn't done those earlier, right? I mean, the Americans had been doing the quadrennial defense reviews for years. I don't know when they started those, actually. But it's always important to be planning for the future. And they must have done it in different ways. But what were you thinking when you were pushing for the SDR?
Well, while I was looking after Scottish devolution, other people were calling for a fundamental review of Britain's defence. And the opposition was saying that this had to happen. And I think the department wanted it. I think the military wanted it very much so, because we'd had all the other sort of, you know, minor reviews, frontline first, defence cost analysis, all of these things.
Right.
Were basically salami slicing.
Right, no one brought it together
overarching. And to do it sort of fundamentally and look at everything with a clean sheet of paper. So we looked at all of the capabilities, what did we needed? And that's why I think it survived as a review. And I used to joke and say that if it had been a success, it would be called the SDR 1998. If it had been a failure, it would have been the Robertson Review. So I'm glad to say that my name is not associated with it. Because it was, you know, highly successful. We were lucky.
Yeah.
In as much as we had a year and a half without a major sort of external conflict, and that allowed us to do the kind of clean sheet thinking that that was required of that, and it survived for 11 years before it was even attempted again. And now, you know, it's a perpetual review, and that's the way it should be.
Yeah. No, it's very important exercise for everyone. And I actually think it's important the way that the SDSR brings together civilian and military parts of government together. I don't think the US model doesn't do that. They have a separate one for the civilian side, the diplomatic side and development side, and then they have the defense one. I think it's important to bring all the tools of government together in one review. It's complicated, but it's important to do.
Well, I think so. And in fact, before the 2010 election, Paddy Ashdown and I co-chaired a major study for the IPPR on national security with a very distinguished sort of panel of people to help us. And we made the very clear recommendation, you know, that there should be an SDSR, that it should include security and foreign policy. And also that there should be a National Security Council and these sort of things. And the Conservatives actually took that section of our report and basically put it in their manifesto. Mm. So I like to think, were the godfathers of the National Security Council, which didn't exist before.
Right.
And the idea of a security and defence review as part of the same thing.
Right.
I thought it was crazy that Gordon Brown, when we went to see his people, they didn't actually pick it up, but it was academic. They lost the election, but David Cameron and his people picked it up.
They did pick it up
and implemented it.
And I should correct myself. The U.S. has a national security strategy, but it hasn't automatically been the chapeau under which the defense and development reviews have. I mean, it hasn't been done as in such an organized way as it should have been done. But maybe post Trump it will, because I don't think he's quite interested in these strategies or implementing them in any way.
No, they've got a lot of strategies, and they're big and they're complicated, and they sort of get lost in the clutter. And the quadrennial defense review is perpetually sort of affected because of the way American politics works. Mm. You know, base closures.
Right.
You know, for us were something that had to be done and were done, and we took the political course. In America, you know, the base closure program always hits the buffers against local politics.
Right. Right, because they're so spread out in so many different states. I mean, it's the Pentagon has been very clever in protecting its budget by basically having some aspect of it in pretty much every state in America, so that there's job implications at the local level.
But it means that they can't, in many ways, you know, scythe through the duplication and the bureaucracy.
It's so complicated, exactly.
So there's an enormous amount of waste involved in the four services rivalry, as well as, you know, the geographic or political elements too.
That's a huge challenge. Now, during your tenure as Defense Secretary, you had a couple major challenges. The UK participated in East Timor, the airstrikes in Iraq in 1998. And then, of course, I guess for you, you went when the bombing in Kosovo started in I guess it was in early 1999, yeah. February, March or something, right?
March.
In March, yeah. 1999. And then you very soon transitioned to the head of NATO. So basically, just after the bombing campaign ended, they asked you to be the Secretary General of NATO. Isn't that right? October, you started in October. Until October, you were still Secretary of Defense here, Minister. Yeah.
I think for 2 weeks, I had 2 weeks when I was technically unemployed, I suppose. Yeah.
Right. But that's actually a very important transition to make because you obviously understood all those challenges. And then you go into NATO and you were there for basically 4 years, right? And there were a number of really challenges, right? There was enlargement of the alliance, with Central and Eastern Europe. You had obviously the Kosovo. Actually, Afghanistan was before Kosovo and NATO.
No, it wasn't. Kosovo was 99.
Oh, you're right. You're right.
Bosnia, 95. Right. Okay. Kosovo. Right.
Kosovo. Okay. So 99.
So right. It was after. I was in the sort of the aftermath of Kosovo, and then leading on through, you know, to Afghanistan.
Right. Okay.
With Macedonia and
Macedonia, and actually when Bosnia and everything was hitting, that was earlier anyway. So Kosovo was a very important engagement because it was complicated. The UN was managing the civilian component of the government there. And then, of course, NATO was managing the defense component. And that was an important change for UN peacekeeping because it was two chains of command. And, of course, the civilian leadership, the SRSG, the Special Representative of the Secretary General, had to work very closely with the head of the NATO commander on the ground. So the first one was Bernard Kouchner and General Jackson. Before him was Sergio de Mello, right? But then it was Kouchner and Jackson. And I remember when I worked in Kosovo in 2000, that every single day, Kouchner and Jackson, and then his successors, Reinhardt and others who came in, they met every single day to make sure that they would work very closely together. Otherwise, it was complicated. And then, of course, the NATO Atlantic Council was also weighing in on all major decisions. The UN was weighing in on decisions. You had the Friends of Kosovo, four or five countries were weighing in. So there were many different bosses in the mix, but somehow it seemed to work pretty well.
I think it worked partly because the personalities involved got on with each other, and that makes a difference. You know, and they also had substantial powers at that time.
Yeah.
So they were able to make executive decisions. And, you know, sort of that's why we failed to learn some lessons when we went to Afghanistan. You know, I think it's one of the problems we have in the international sphere is that we sort of, you know, it's sort of job and finish. Mm-hmm. We write reports about lessons learned, but we rarely implement them so that the lessons learned from Bosnia were not translated over to Kosovo, the lessons from Kosovo
into
Afghanistan,
Iraq.
And certainly not to Iraq. Right. You know, when there were some of them manifestly obvious at the time, but you know, Kosovo worked. You know, the military campaign had been successful, not a single Allied casualty involved in that. Right. And what we said at the beginning, the objectives were summed up in one phrase, which was Serbs out, NATO in, refugees home.
Yeah.
You know, so a very simple way of articulating what the objectives of the mission
very
were.
Good point.
And they were all achieved.
Right.
And again, you know, if you tried to do that elsewhere, that would have focused people's minds on it. So you had a good civilian representative in the Sergio de Mello and then Kouchner, and you had good military representatives there working closely together. Without detailed interference, but with policy guidance coming, you know, as you say, complicated the North Atlantic Council, the European Union, you know, the United Nations.
All those agencies, the OSCE, do you remember? They were also there doing their own thing. Yeah, no, I remember being in the middle of it, and I was so impressed by how well, generally, I mean, obviously there were challenges, but as you say, it's a very important point you just made about having a clear understanding of what the mission was, because even once the Serbs were out and the Albanians were back, then of course we had to protect the Serb minorities. But our mission at the UN was to transition over to local ownership, right? And that was pretty much all it was. When you go to Afghanistan, and I had been there many times subsequently, you never really understood what the mission was. And I don't think most people agreed who were there what the mission was. I mean, you'd ask five different people and you'd get five different answers. Whereas you're right about Kosovo, people were very clear what the mission was. And that is important. That's an excellent point. Now, can we, I'm bouncing around a little bit, but I do want to talk about enlargement because, of course, many people say that that was one of the reasons that Putin has become so, let's just say, he's become so defensive, semi-aggressive, insecure, whatever it might be, because of NATO enlargement. And other people have made the case that it would have been crazy not to do enlargement at the time. And those countries didn't want to be affiliated with Russia. And we, at that time, were working, trying to work with Russia. You had made enormous efforts to work closely with Putin, set up a number of coordinating mechanisms. Do you think that NATO enlargement is partially to blame for, let's just say, a resurgent, aggressive Russia that we're seeing today?
Well, the handling of enlargement might well have contributed to that. You know, I keep saying to people that during all of the 3 years that I dealt with Vladimir Putin, and I had nine meetings with him during that period of time. So that's pretty intensive. Yeah. He never mentioned NATO enlargement once. Sorry, he mentioned it once over the Baltic states and to do with the adapted CFE treaty, or the Conventional Forces in Europe treaty, which perversely adds the Baltic states military in with the, you know, the Russian side of it as well. And so that there was an element of that. So I needed to get the Baltic states to commit to the adapted CFE treaty. And with some difficulty because of political problems in the State Department in America, I managed to get the states to do that. And at a meeting we had in Brussels with Putin, I said I'd got this agreement on that. So the foreign ministry then said, the Russian foreign ministry said, well, we've got other things as well. And he said, that's it. That's the commitment I wanted. And that was the only time that he actually did it. Now, looking back and thinking about it a lot since then, I think it was the onward march of the European Union that bothered Putin most in Russia. He had a good relationship with NATO, and the relationship with NATO was a straightforward one. We were a military, he considered us to be a military alliance, right, although NATO is more than that. And they always understood NATO. You know, they assumed that the Americans ran it wrongly, but they assumed that. But they could see it, and NATO had a Secretary General who would come and could do a deal and deliver it back again. The European Union was completely sort of funny to them. You know, I remember one of the officials saying, when you come representing NATO, you come and you can talk on behalf of NATO. If the European Union comes, we have Javier Solana, the High Representative, we have Christopher Patton, who is the External Affairs Commissioner, and we have the Foreign Minister of Luxembourg. That's the EU. You know, what is this about? And also what I think they thought was that the EU changed countries, completely changed them, you know, from command economies to mixed economies, from dictatorship to democracies, you know, from the rule of the center to the rule of law. And that in a way was a more remarkable thing that was there. So I think in a way, when Russia decided that it was going to break from Western values or from identifying with the West, it was much more seeing that this influence coming across towards them was much more worrying to them. It shouldn't have been, but I think when you eventually get into a bunker, you start imagining things like that. So I don't think NATO enlargement was seen as being something. Had we gone, if we had involved Ukraine or Georgia or Armenia or Belarus, I think that might have been different. But in as much as we were dealing with those other countries, he never mentioned it at all.
Right, that's very interesting. That's an interesting perspective. And then, of course, 9/11 happens, and you were the first Secretary General to invoke Article 5. And it's a bit ironic that Trump is making threatening noises about NATO when the only time NATO has invoked Article 5 was in support of the United States when it was attacked.
Yeah, it's ironic. If you look at the debates that took place around Article 5 in 1949, and especially in the American Senate, where there was, you know, deep reservations, right, you know, you know, one American senator saying, you know, this, we know what this is about. It's these Europeans are going to get into another war and expect us to fight it again for them. You know, then all these years later, it's invoked because America has been attacked from outside. So, you know, that was in some ways ironic, but it's what NATO was for.
Right.
You know, that you know, I sat down that day and said to people, look, you know, it's a big thing. I know that if you'd had a tabletop exercise on the 9th of September, mm-hmm. you know, 2001, and you said, you know, civilian airliners hit buildings in New York and in Washington, would you invoke Article 5? The clever people around the table would say, hang on, that's not what it was for. It was Russian, you know, Soviet tanks coming across the North German plains. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not to do with terrorism or an attack on mm-hmm. civilian buildings. But on the day, you know, at the time, that is what it was for. Mm-hmm. It was the Allies standing by, an ally that was under a formidable attack from outside, and the world changed that mm-hmm. day. And Article 5 was part of that right. change taking place.
When that decision was made, how long did you deliberate about it?
Well, we obviously had to think about it that day, but you had to think very quickly. Mm-hmm. And we put it to the statement went to the North Atlantic Council. I think it was 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and at 8:30, the council agreed. Mm-hmm. You know, I had to spend a lot of time on the phone, and I had mm-hmm. to use every bit of political skill, judgment, yes. guile.
Scottish training was coming in.
Well, way back to my West of Scotland political training, you know. But of course, the next day, everyone knew yeah. it was the most wonderful idea in the world. And, you know, I now keep reading and listening to people taking credit for it, you know. So I don't get jealous. it was the right decision to take. And if other people want, you know, to share the parenthood, then I'm more than happy about it, because it united.
Right.
NATO at that point behind the United States in a way that it was always designed for, and that I think took NATO into a new space, mm-hmm. you know, into a future generation as well, because it had crossed in many ways a Rubicon, but recreated itself. Mm-hmm. It was reborn.
Yeah, right, right. Re-energized.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, I think NATO, though, in many ways, the Balkans, or in Kosovo in particular, also gave it new meaning, because before that there had been a debate, right? Do we need NATO anymore? The Cold War is over. What's the purpose of it? I remember all of that. But then I think Kosovo really, because it had gone fairly well, it was also, you know, gave NATO that burst of energy. And then, of course, after 9/11, when NATO went into Afghanistan, that was the first out-of-area operation, right?
NATO. Out of area.
Yeah, right.
You know, certainly out of the North Atlantic sort of area. It's right. But again, you know, I had to sell the idea of going into Afghanistan, right. You know. So we had Article 5, then we had the Americans saying what they wanted from Article 5, mm-hmm. which was a range of facilities that came from that. Then there were coalitions of the willing set up to deal with the post-conflict Afghanistan.
Right. It was Turkey and all different countries that were rotating leadership, weren't they? Turkey was the first, wasn't
Turkey
it?
Turkey was one. I think Britain was first, and then it was Turkey.
Okay.
And we were going to struggle after that because they had to take a headquarters. Right. You know, for the lay readers, I know that a Rusi podcast goes to people who know what a headquarters is. But
it's
a headquarters,
worth explaining.
A headquarters, you know, involves all of the different elements, you know, that are involved in an operation, you know. So you've got to plug in these different component parts. So it's a very complicated thing for any individual nation to operate. And NATO has it in the Supreme Headquarters, Allied Powers Europe shape. Mm-hmm. It is the headquarters, because it has all of the different elements and component parts with that. But there was a lot of resistance to that. There was resistance from America. Mm-hmm. You know, Donald Rumsfeld said, we've done our bit. You know, we actually defeated the Taliban. That's, you know, you can clean up after that. Tony Blair was saying, no, we're not going to do it. We've already done one of the headquarters there, and that was a major effort by us. The French were not keen for NATO to be way out of area, so there was a reluctance by them. And then we had the problems, you know, with the people in the neighborhood. So I had to go and persuade Vladimir Putin, that NATO in Afghanistan was a good idea, and he agreed. They wanted to stabilize Afghanistan. I went to Uzbekistan, spoke to President Karimov. I went to Turkmenistan, President Rahman. I went to Kyrgyz Republic. Mm-hmm. I spoke to General Musharraf, Pakistan. I wasn't allowed to speak to the Iranians.
I was about to say, what about the Iranians? Yeah.
That would have been logical, and that would have been the right thing to do. And they wanted to speak, but I wasn't, because America had a view at the time. And we spoke to the Chinese. And the Chinese were actually more enthusiastic about NATO taking over the role in Afghanistan than the French were. Mm. And then I had to persuade Tony Blair. I had to persuade President Bush. And I did that in a meeting where he changed the policy on the spot. The French eventually agreed as well. So NATO took it over, but it wasn't, you know, history will say it just went, you know, sort of defeat of the Taliban, then it was Turkey, UK, and then NATO took over as if it was natural.
Right.
Sure as hell was not natural, right. And it required a huge amount of arguing and leveraging and diplomatic effort to get it.
Right, and getting it set up properly. Now, what do you think, 18 years on, and the mission is still there, and it's not entirely clear, the Taliban probably has control of, what, half the country right now, or at least there are shadow Taliban governments in many, many provinces now in Afghanistan. What are your thoughts about next steps in Afghanistan?
Well, let's think about previous steps. What should we have done? I think the lessons of Kosovo were strong civilian representation alongside the military, clear objectives, you know, and strong civilian things. And you know, I regret in a way that what we did in Kosovo and what we did in Bosnia wasn't done in Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. We had a president in Afghanistan, to be fair, so it was more complicated. But I think we needed to have that diplomatic sort of defense policy side reinforced alongside high-powered military. Secondly...
Well, just if I can interrupt you on that one, because don't forget also, you had a different American government that was less into working in partnerships, let's just say.
Yeah.
Right? And so that also, they probably could, they might have interfered with a stronger political peace being set up. And the UN at the time was also, remember, Brahimi was hoping for this light footprint operation.
Yeah, I know. Too. That's right. No, there were complications, but I think you sometimes have to be robust in terms of what you know. So Paddy Ashton was talked about as a civilian representative. He'd done such a really good job in Bosnia, but President Karzai did not want somebody of that sort of political character to be there. And I think that was a mistake. Much more importantly is we did not fight a psychological war. You know, in Kosovo, we did press conferences every day for the 78 days of that conflict. Mm-hmm. And we got into the mind of the Serbs that they were going to be defeated. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, I think that probably worked more than the bombing campaign. Mm-hmm. In Afghanistan, people lost interest. Mm-hmm. Gordon Brown made one speech in Parliament about Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. David Cameron made one single speech about Afghanistan in Parliament. You cannot in this day and age sort of leave the military to go out there a long, long way away and simply honor the dead when they come home while not giving hope to the people alive, giving fear to the enemy, and reassuring the people that you're actually helping that the people of the West generally are on their side. And I think that was a mistake. And therefore, looking forward, we should learn that lesson and sort of say, right, you know, Afghanistan has disappeared from view, and yet it's still there. You know, President Trump has been obliged against his election pledges to put more troops into that area. And yet we're still not telling people why we're there, what we're doing. We're not fighting in any way that information war that is required for people on the ground. And, you know, I think I've often used the example during Kosovo. I took a party out to Macedonia and to Albania and to HMS Invincible, the aircraft carrier at the time. And I took the Shadow Foreign Secretary, then Michael Howard, who'd been a minister in the Conservative government. I took Min Campbell, the Liberal Democrat spokesman, I took the chairman of the Foreign Affairs Committee, and we went out together.
Right.
And the signal was to the Serb General Command was, you know, this is not the British government. This is the British people and the British Parliament. And that was reassuring to the people who were fighting, our troops. It was reassuring to the refugees on the ground who were still being persecuted by Milosevic at the time. And it told the Serbian high command that they were up against not just Tony Blair's government or Bill Clinton's government. They were actually up against a much more formidable foe. And I think if we did that in Afghanistan, if we did it in Iraq, if we bothered to do it now, the outcome, I think, would be different.
Yeah, it's a very good point, because also in the Balkans campaigns, generally Western troops were not targeted, whereas in Afghanistan and Iraq later, of course, there were many body bags coming back. And so there is even more of a need to communicate, and not communicating as much as you were saying, really also made so many people back home say, what are we doing there? Why are we there? Why are these kids getting killed? Yeah.
Well, we never really said to people on a consistent, regular basis why we were there and why it mattered to them.
Right.
You know, I used to go and say, I remember going to one of the countries in NATO and say, why are we sending our young people, you know, thousands of miles over the Torabora Mountains? I said, well, either we go to Afghanistan or Afghanistan comes to us.
Right.
You know, and that is what it is. It's about the turmoil that was created in Afghanistan now spreading. And then it spread into Syria, where again, we didn't learn lessons about being firm in the first place and actually running information campaigns alongside any military campaign.
Right. No, I make this point all the time. You ignore these places at your peril because they do come back and bite you. And Syria, by not doing more in Syria, bit all of us because of the refugee crisis in particular, but also ISIL as well. It was allowed to metastasize and spread in Syria because we didn't do more. Now, you really were in NATO in a very important time because, of course, then Iraq, the invasion of Iraq, which really, unfortunately...
Well, before we get to that, Karin, can I say you missed out one important ingredient here. In 2001, before 9/11 took place, there was an insurgency into what was called the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia.
Right.
You know, and
that was the only preventive mission, that we can all think of. Whenever people say, "When has conflict prevention worked?" and Macedonia, you're right, it was a very important.
And it brought together the European Union and NATO together there. You know, Javier Solana and I went down with the OSCE representative Mircea Jurana, you know, 11 times, you know, during that year, and we turned around an insurgency into a peace agreement, stability, and the leader of the insurgency has been in the government of that country almost consistently since then. And this year, the new prime minister of what is now called North Macedonia and the prime minister of Greece used all of their political capital in order to get an agreement on the name, which will allow North Macedonia to become a member of NATO. So, you know, we prevented what was almost inevitably going to be another Balkan civil war taking place. And it would have been very bloody and hugely expensive as well. And I think, again, the lessons of that were very clear about engagement, about information, about contacts, and, you know, and the whole process of diplomacy. So, you know,
Thank you for that. And in fact, it was another example. I think Macedonia was another example of, or North Macedonia, as you say today, of making sure that the external powers were coordinated and speaking with one voice. Because it's very easy for, you know, various actors in a conflict to manipulate external powers. Yeah. And so I think that Macedonia was another example, like Kosovo, where they were speaking with one voice, unlike in other places, as we were saying. Okay, now can we talk about Iraq?
Yeah.
Okay. So, you know, I mean, we don't need to revisit all the mistakes made in Iraq, but NATO didn't actually play much of a role anyway once the invasion happened, because, of course, the U.S. wanted to tightly control that whole operation. So what was happening in NATO at that time, I guess? What was going through your entree during that whole invasion period, or were you focused mostly on Afghanistan?
No. We were embroiled, obviously, in Iraq. But the reason we weren't directly involved is because there was no consensus.
Right.
You know, there was and without consensus,
did someone try to get NATO to run the Iraq?
No, there was never
a suggestion.
There was not. You know, France and other countries,
right,
Germany were against it in the first place. So there was no chance of that. And yet at the same time, even those countries said that the countries who did want to help, you know, Poland, Spain, for example.
New Europe.
Portugal was another country that was actively supporting the United States. So they would get certain help from NATO resources, but there would be no NATO involvement. But it had a huge impact on NATO as a whole. And in fact, in the lead up to the invasion, NATO almost broke.
Yeah,
it's not really remembered well because of what happened after that, but. The Turkey believed that it was going to be attacked by Saddam as a countermeasure. Mm-hmm. They thought to take attention away from the south. So Turkey invoked Article 4 of the North Atlantic Treaty, mm-hmm. which is the one that says a country says we believe we might be attacked mm-hmm. and we want help from the alliance. So you know they were wanting Patriot missile systems and the rest of it, and that was going to be blocked by France, Germany. Luxembourg and Belgium. Mm-hmm. So, I then had a diplomatic crisis because if we put that to the North Atlantic Council, they would have vetoed it.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to prevent it even going mm-hmm. to the Council and then try to negotiate something. NATO operates by decision sheets. So mm-hmm. a proposition is put out mm-hmm. to the nations. And if nobody objects, that becomes the policy, that becomes consensus, and it needs consensus to break it. So if I'd put out the decision sheet saying that we would help Turkey and they'd vetoed it, that would have been a dramatic escalation. And it could have broken mm-hmm. NATO as a whole, because that would have been the very first time a nation had asked for help and had been refused it. So there was a diplomatic crisis at that time, and I had to gradually sort of peel the countries off, find solutions until eventually we got an agreement that Turkey would get the protection that it had. So that was one way in which...
Is that when the Patriots went into Turkey?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't realize that. Okay. And then, of course, Turkey didn't let, what was it, the U.S. use... And maybe the UK, northern Turkey, too.
Incirlik, the air base, the big air base in southern Turkey. So the Americans were planning, to take troops in there. So Turkey has always been a sort of prickly member mm-hmm. of the alliance, but everyone is this
better in than out.
I think that's the.
But yeah, then of course, when Iraq happened as well, many of you were probably concerned about your assets being removed from Afghanistan by many of the countries that participated, as you were saying. So there was that spillover. And then I think there was a period as well when Afghanistan was kind of forgotten because the focus was so much on all the challenges in Iraq. And that was really to the detriment of Afghanistan. Sometimes it isn't a bad thing to be ignored because maybe you can get on with it when you're out there and you're doing the right thing, but it didn't seem to work that way in Afghanistan during that period.
Yeah, right? I think that was one of the real downsides, that attention moved away. And you have to have political focus.
Mm-hmm.
That was another, Bosnia, Kosovo, Macedonia, there was a fixed attention paid to it, and everyone engaged in that. But, when you've got two massive things going on and Iraq going wrong, mm-hmm. starting to go wrong after the hugely successful invasion. And I think it was the very success of that operation that led to the problems, because all the planning was based on difficulties, and then what do we do after the difficulties? Mm-hmm. When there weren't any difficulties and the army went home and the civilian sort of structure disappeared, and the Department of Defense in America decided that they wanted then to control the situation rather than the State Department, that is when things started to go badly wrong.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we probably should be accelerating a bit because we've been we're running a little bit out of time, but there are a few more things to talk about. So then, tell me a little bit. I mean, how worried are you about NATO today? I know there will be a summit here in the UK in December of this year. President Trump has made, let's just say, not pleasant noises about the importance of NATO. Maybe it's not a bad thing for NATO to rethink its purpose and the way it does business. So, sometimes these disruptive periods can be a positive thing for an organization. And I think, one positive thing you can say about Trump's style is I think we all just got used to taking certain institutions for granted and maybe hadn't been thinking as much about reform, whether it's the UN, whether it's NATO, whether it's the EU even. And so I do think sometimes these disruptive periods can be positive forces for change if they're managed properly. But what are your thoughts about the future of NATO, about the summit, about America's view of it?
Well, I think you're right that the last thing NATO needs is to be ignored or to be forgotten about. So keeping it in the headlines is no bad thing, because right. It is hugely important, because it's not, it's not just a military organization, although that is, one of its central features, but it's also a political, scientific, educational. It's got all these different arms involved in it that are hugely important for keeping those nations and the partnership nations, mm-hmm. the other nations the outside of NATO, including Russia and Ukraine and the others, involved in thinking about general security terms. So it's remarkably successful. Indeed, I was talking to a Royal Marine dinner last week, and I was making the point that we celebrated D-Day, and we watched all the film of these guys plowing through the waters onto the beaches and under fire, 10,000 casualties on D-Day alone, 4,000 people dead, And if you'd said to the guys, on the beach under fire, 75 years' time, mm-hmm. our preoccupation is going to be that these Germans up there are not serious enough about defense. They're not spending enough on the hardware that is required, But that transformation of Germany from being this horror of the Nazis into being a country that is actually saying, we're not actually terribly interested in being a military power, is because NATO brought all these countries together. So its constant reinvention and readaptation is crucially important to its function and what it does in the future. So I think there will be questioning, of course, and there will be people who say, no, the European Union is there, or the United Nations is better, but NATO actually works, mm-hmm. and works really, really well. So President Trump is supposed to have said in private, why don't we get out of NATO? He says the Allies are not paying enough money. He refused to talk about Article 5 when he was at the opening of the new headquarters. But actually, that's the rhetoric. In reality, he's getting on brilliantly well with Stoltenberg, Jens Stoltenberg, the current Secretary General, apparently likes him and indeed suggested that his term be extended, rather than going through the formalities of getting another Secretary General at the end of his term. He's putting extra money into the European Defence Initiative, I think they call it, and putting extra troops into Poland, into the rotations that are taking place. So actually, he's doing much more, even although the noise is there. And Jens Stoltenberg is the first ever Secretary General of NATO to address both houses of Congress. Mm. In fact, he's the first leader of any multilateral organization to address both houses of the American Congress.
Well, I think he understands that lesson you made earlier, the point you made earlier about communication, yeah. Right? I mean, obviously, he knows that America is a bit of a hard sell right now, and he's making an enormous effort, and he's succeeding.
Yeah, but the invitation came from the Congress.
Right. They were worried too, obviously.
Yeah.
Right? Because Congress is very supportive of NATO, and yeah. I think that they've been concerned about President Trump. I mean, look, I think you can say, yes, he gets along with Stoltenberg, and Stoltenberg has flattered him, which he, of course, likes. But I would say some of those other decisions you mentioned about Poland and troop rotations, et cetera, I'm not sure how much he knows about all of those details. I don't think he's a detail man. So I think a lot of the bureaucracy is able to keep things moving along because Trump doesn't always know what's happening on the ground.
Yeah, but it, you know, it's sort of, but the noises haven't led to anything specific actually taking place, you know. So we'll see when the summit takes place in London at the end of the year. But I think, you know, he's a guy who actually likes success. You know, that's his thing. And he likes big deal.
He likes deals, but I don't think he understands the importance of alliances. I think that's one of his challenges because he's always ever done every one of his successes, if they are successes, he's done them all by himself. And, you know, he sees everything in a zero-sum way. That's my personal view of his, the way he deals with things. So I don't think he fully fundamentally understands the importance of partnerships and what partners bring to the table. So I think he just sees it as, you know, well, we win, you lose, you win, we lose. That has been a challenge, I think, with him as a president for many of America's allies.
But he wins with NATO. You know, you get 29 other allies, you know, as part of the bargain.
Right.
And a bargain is something that he seems to appreciate, you know.
Right. So we're coming to the end. You then left in 2004 when your term ended. And when you were already in the House of Lords at that time, so you went back to the House of Lords directly. And then you have a range of directorships. There's too many to mention, some charities and some think tanks, universities, et cetera, as well as some private sector engagements. Your portfolio is quite large. Are you having trouble remembering all the things that you have to do?
Well, I was a member of parliament for 21 years, so you get used to dealing with a whole range of different issues and trying to keep them all sort of balanced at the same time. So the juggling is now part of my life as well, you know. So, you know, it's difficult, but I work under pressure. I like working under pressure.
Very good, very good. And it looks really fascinating, the mix in your portfolio. But we don't have time to go through any of that right now, because we're nearing the end of this very interesting conversation. I think we certainly could talk for hours about a number of the issues that we discussed.
Let me highlight one to you. I'm the chairman of a thing called the FIA Foundation, which is a global road safety charity. I've got a great passion for road safety. You know,
yes, after your
road
accident.
I had an accident myself and I was saved because I was wearing a seatbelt. But, you know, road crashes kill more young people in the world today than anything else. Wow. It's the biggest single killer of young people. Mm. And we know what to do about it. You know, we know what it's to do with drink, with helmets, with seatbelts, you know, and with designing of roads. You know, and I just feel that, you know, we get preoccupied with terrorism and with conflicts, you know, but in the world today, more people are dying from suicide than in all the wars and all the homicides in the world. And you know, road safety is just, the carnage is huge. Yeah. You know, so think about military, the military casualties are tiny in comparison to what's going on. And when we know the answer to it, then we really need to do something about it.
Driverless cars will help if we can get them to not kill civilians.
Yeah, well, I think they will probably be better.
And what about these flying cars? We're going to be in these Jetson
types. Let's see what happens in the future. I think that'll happen after we've gone. But, you know, I was talking to former Prime Minister of France recently, who was making the point that they reduced their road casualties dramatically by importing a British idea. Now, you don't get many French ex-prime ministers saying a British import did it. Roundabouts. They had no roundabouts in France. They brought in roundabouts very controversially. Dramatic impact. Dramatic impact.
As long as it's not like the one in Swindon, right?
Well, the one in Swindon works. Because I remember going there because it's close to Chivenham and the Defence Academy. And I said, is this an experiment? They say, 30 years old, you know. Well, and it works, you know.
There's only one in the UK, right? There isn't another one like that.
Yeah, eight roundabouts in a single complex, you know. But, you know.
You just drive straight through the middle.
They know how to do it, yeah. So
and then I have one final question, but just one other point I wanted to make was that I noticed and you had received a number of honors from foreign governments, from Germany, Romania, from the United States, the Presidential Medal of Freedom, from the Netherlands, Croatia, Estonia. So that's 1/5 of NATO members, which is quite nice. But any thoughts about any of those particular, you know, the recognition you've received? Are there any interesting stories about any of those?
Well, for the boy who was born in a police station in a tiny village in the west of Scotland, it's, you know, it, it, it's not something you would ever even have thought about or contemplated to do with that. But I'm a knight of the thistle in Scotland. So there's only 16 knights of the thistle, the oldest, one of the oldest honours in the UK, and personally chosen by the Queen. So that is really quite something. And I'm only one of two people in the UK to have the American Presidential Medal of Freedom.
Who's the other?
Tony Blair. Oh, wow. Tony Blair has it. Lord Carrington had it as well. And he's just recently died. So, and it's very rarely given to foreigners. And they only give about 30 a year in the United States. It's quite strange when the American military give large numbers of medals that they only have one civilian one as well. So, you know, these are nice things, you know, to have. But you know, I'd rather be useful in life.
Well, I remember seeing you once when you were Secretary General, and I think that you just had this entourage with you that impressed me, all your bodyguards and everyone following you with their papers and this movement down the corridor is quite impressive.
Well, I've been at the Paris Air Show this week, and I watched other entourages going around there, you know, as an ordinary sort of individual standing on the sidelines. So these things exist for a moment or two, and then they disappear. Right. You know,
you can't take them. You can't assume it'll be there for life. Now, the final question that I ask everyone really is, what kind of advice would you give for the younger generation thinking about a career in international affairs, international security, given how many changes there have been in the world? Do you have any interesting thoughts for that next generation?
Get involved. Be involved. You know, I joined my first political party when I was 15 and left it when I was 16 and joined the Labour Party. I was in the SNP, which is well recorded. But, you know, people talk about politics and politicians, you know, well, they've got a responsibility to be involved. Political parties are tiny in comparison to the population, and yet, look, we've got one now, 160,000 people out of a population of 56 million will choose who the prime minister is going to be in 4 weeks' time. That, you know, that can't be right.
Yeah.
You know, so people need to get involved and engaged and at the earliest possible. You know, you can change parties, you can be involved in them and move around them, you know, depending on what they do and what you do. But, you know, if the political process gets atrophied because people are not joining and being involved and playing a part, then we all pay a price, and it's a pretty hefty price as well if things go wrong. And Brexit should have told people at the moment, you know, that the broader the base of the decision-making, then the better the decision is likely to be, and the more people will be bought into it at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, thank you for that. The Right Honourable the Lord Robertson in Port Ellen, many thanks for joining us today.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you for listening to this episode of In Context with Lord Robertson. Please do subscribe to our podcast and don't forget to send us your comments and suggestions. We will be back in a month with another interesting guest.
This podcast was produced by Tom Ascott, developed by Caroline Tranter, with further research from Neil Watling. Keep up to date with the latest defense and security analysis by visiting www.rusi.org.